Pod disruption budget helps you to run highly available applications even when you introduce frequent voluntary disruptions. For example, a cluster administrator can drain a node for repair, upgrade, or maybe just to scale down the cluster. Pod disruption budget can only protect you from voluntary disruptions. In voluntary disruptions, such as hardware failure or node disappearing from the cluster due to a cluster network partition, cannot be prevented by PDBs. However, they do count against the budget. There are a few ways to mitigate involuntary disruptions in general. Ensure your pod requests the resources it needs. Replicate your application if you need higher availability. For even higher availability when running replicated applications, spread applications across Kubernetes nodes using anti-affinity. On top of it, as application owner, you can create pod disruption budget PDB for each application. A PDB limits the number of pods that can be down at the same time. For example, you have 3 replicas of the Nginx ingress controller. You want to make sure that only one pod can be down at any given time. It can be achieved with the following PDB configuration. If more pods are down, it can lead to overloading Nginx and causing downtime for applications that use ingress. Here is an example of the simple deployment with Nginx and 3 replicas. For the demo, I also included pod anti-affinity to spread Nginx pods between Kubernetes nodes. In a previous video, we discussed the differences between node selector and affinity. Also, I gave 5 examples of how to use it. For this demo, I prepared a 3-node Kubernetes cluster in AWS, which I created with ecosytl. Now let's create a deployment and make sure that all pods run on different nodes. You can run kubectl get pods -o wide to get a node for each pod. They all have different node names. Next, we need to create pod disruption budget. First of all, if you want to prevent any interruptions to your application in the cluster, you can set the min available attribute equal to the number of pods. It will prevent any voluntary interruptions on your deployment. It will not even allow for a Kubernetes upgrade, since you must drain node first, but the current PDB configuration will block it. We will see it in a moment. Next is a selector. Here you need to select pod labels and not deployment. If you go back to the deployment, I intentionally gave the app equal Nginx controller label to differentiate it from the deployment object. The way it works, PDB will check the metadata owner references field of the pod and get the parent object from there. Now let's apply pod disruption budget. The best way to verify the status is to describe the PDB object. We have a total of 3 pods, desired and current number is 3 as well. Allowed disruptions are an important field that will tell you how many pods can be down at the same time. Since it's 0 means disruptions are not allowed. The caveat here is that the tools that I use to work with Kubernetes have to respect PDB and use eviction API first instead of directly deleting pods. For example, you would frequently use kubectl drain and unchardon commands when you upgrade the cluster or scale up and down nodes in Kubernetes. Drain removes a node from the service and unchardon returns node to the cluster. Kubectl drain will use evict API and respect PDB. Let's try it out. Let's get all the nodes first. Then pick one of them to remove from the cluster. Use kubectl drain with the name of the node. It will give you an error first, since we need to explicitly specify that we want to evict daemon set managed pods and pods with local storage. Let's rerun it again and add those flags to the kubectl drain node command. Now we have an error. Cannot evict the pod as it would violate the pod disruption budget. So it's not possible to even upgrade the cluster with this PDB config. You should almost never use it. A more realistic approach for this deployment would be to allow one pod to be down. Let's update the YAML and apply it. Rerun the same kubectl drain command. Now the pod was evicted and rescheduled on a different node. Keep in mind that pod disruption budget only works with voluntary disruptions. Cluster managers and hosting providers should use tools that respect pod disruption budget by calling the eviction API instead of directly deleting pods or deployments. If you want more videos like this, subscribe to my channel. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.